All right, before we start, let's begin our worship with prayer. Our Father in heaven, we give thanks to Thee for this beautiful day, and now we thank Thee, Father, for this time of worship. We pray, Heavenly Father, that You would bless us as we work together as a congregation to reach out to the lost in this community, and Father, help us to always put on the mindset of searching for those seeking for the truth, and to examine our lives so that we're living our lives pure and spotless in Thy sight, and that we may shine as lights in this world so that we may be able to teach others, that others will feel comfortable talking to us about the church, about salvation. Father, we pray that You would bless this time tonight with our worship. And we pray, Father, in Jesus' name, amen.
We'll now turn to number 42. Beulah Land. Number 42. I've reached the land of love divine, and all its riches freely mine. Here shines and dimmed one blissful day, for all my life has passed away. Oh, Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land, as on the highest mount I stand, I look away across the sea where mansions are prepared for me, and view the shining glory shore, my heaven, my home forevermore. My Savior comes and walks with me, and sweet communion here have we. He gently leads me by His hand, for this is heaven's borderland. Oh, Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land, as on the highest mount I stand, I look away across the sea where mansions are prepared for me, and you shining glory shore, my heaven, my sweet perfume upon the breeze is born from ever vernal trees, and flowers that never fading grow where streams of life forever flow. Oh, Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land, as on the highest mount I stand, I look away across the sea where mansions are prepared for me, and you the shining glory shore, my heaven, my home forevermore. The zephyr seemed to flow to me, sweet sounds of heaven's melody, as angels with the white rose draw, join in the sweet redemption song. Oh, Beulah Land, sweet Beulah Land, as on the highest mount I stand, I look away across the sea where mansions are prepared for me, and you the shining glory shore, my heaven, my home forevermore. And just look right across the page to number 43. And we might go ahead and prepare by turning over to number 718. This will be our song. We'll have the scripture reading after number 43 and the lesson for the evening. And then number 718, Who at the Door is Standing. So now back to number 43, Blessed Assurance. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praise praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, rain from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Scripture reading tonight is from two verses in the book of Romans, first in chapter 2, verse number 13, Romans chapter 2 and verse number 13. It says, "For not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified." And then just two chapters later in chapter 4 and verse number 15, Romans chapter 4 and verse number 15, says, "Because the law brings about wrath, for where there is no law, there is no transgression."
Done a fair amount of pondering this week. I looked back at a sermon that I'd given several years ago, and I thought, oh, that sounds like a good topic to cover. But then the more I looked at it, not that that was wrong, but I thought, you know, I think there are aspects of this that I have not thought about before, or certainly not in the same way. So the topic for tonight is, can we understand the Bible alike? I think that was an important topic years ago. I think maybe it's an even more important topic now. Having a single standard can bring unity among us. Having a single standard, if it's the right standard, can bring us in harmony with God. If we read the Bible from God, it's a very important question. Can we understand the Bible alike? But I would suggest to you there's a question we need to answer before that. Before we say, can we understand the Bible alike, we need to ask the question, can we understand the Bible? Can we understand the Bible at all? And I think this is becoming more controversial all the time. Sometimes people, I think they try to avoid their responsibility to God by saying, oh, who can understand the Bible? All these great theologians in these big universities, they're in such disagreement about the Bible and what it says. How can poor little old me possibly understand it? Well, let us ponder together. As the scriptures would say, let us reason together. Can we understand the Bible? There are many different ways to approach this topic. In other lessons in the past, I've approached it in a slightly different way. But this time, I want us to approach it from a slightly different viewpoint. I believe the way we answer that question reflects on what we believe about God. What a person believes about God it's going to affect the way they answer the question, can we understand the Bible? Let me just kind of in the beginning here list what I called important considerations. One, we believe in God. Now, I know not everybody in the world believes in God. People who do not believe in God, I need to start with a different lesson with them. I think we can lay that foundation. Several months ago, I was having a gospel meeting in South Carolina. And at the same time, they were having a seminar about believing in God. It was interesting. They had a lot of very good material there, and they invited me to speak a lesson about that also. I think we can build an excellent case for the existence of God. We can build a case for the existence of God, and we can further make that linkage that the God that's the creator of the universe is, in fact, the God we read about in the Bible. Some people just make that assumption. I don't think you can make the assumption, but I think you can prove it. So, we believe in God. If you don't believe in God, come see me and we'll start with a different kind of lesson. We believe that the Bible is inspired. And so we believe it's an accurate representation of God's message for us, God's will for us, God's commands for us. And I know not everybody believes that about the Bible. Again, this lesson is for those who do. And we believe that God is righteous. We believe God is fair. We believe that God will judge us in a fair way. You know, sometimes we talk about the judgment day, and there may be uncertainties that we have about the judgment day, but those, I think, are based on our uncertainty about whether we're doing all that we should do or could do. I don't think we ever say, well, I'm concerned about whether God's going to be fair with me or not. I think we believe that. So these, I'm suggesting, are things that are surely believed among us. There is a God. The Bible is an accurate transcription of God's message to us, and we believe that God will judge us in righteous judgment. Now, if we believe the Bible, and I'll talk about that a little bit more later, but if we believe the Bible, then we need to believe that God's going to judge us based on what we do. 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in the body, according to what he has done, whether it's good or evil. There's a strong admonition that we must not just be hearers of the word, we must be doers of the word. God is going to judge us on the basis of what we do. God has not put us on this earth as observers. Christianity is not a spectator sport. We're expected to be participants. We must all follow God's laws, not passively, but we must read them and understand them and follow them. Romans 2:13, for not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. One other point that I want to make so it's clear, where there is no law, there is no sin. Two passages read in the beginning of the lesson both say that. I put Romans 5:13 there. Sin is not imputed where there is no law. The Bible says that for there to be sin, there must be a law. In other words, God does not just say, you're a sinner, you're a sinner, you're a sinner. God gives us his will, and those who follow that will are righteous in his eyes. The others are not. So, sin is not imputed where there is no sin, and yet the scriptures tell us that all have sinned. And what does that mean? All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. If there is no sin where there is no law, then, if all have sinned, all must have been under some law of God. Now, we look in the Old Testament, we look at those under the law of Moses, we look at those who were not under the law of Moses, and yet they were held accountable by God. They were considered unrighteous at times by God. So think carefully. If there is no sin where there is no law and people are considered sinners, then God must have a law for everyone who exists on the face of the earth today, a law for everyone who ever has existed on the face of the earth. Therefore, all are under a law of God. Now, if we believe the scriptures, then we believe that God has expectations for all of us. Now we can ask the question, if God has expectations for all of us and he's going to judge us by some law, would a righteous God judge us by a law that we have not been given? You know, we talk about what we think is fair, and when we get down to it, what we believe is good, what we believe is fair, those evaluations come from God. He is the one that is always good. He is the one that's always fair. He's the one that's always righteous. I would suggest to you that we would not know what good is except for the descriptions we have in the scriptures of God. Would a righteous God judge us by a law that we've not been given? This doesn't seem consistent with our idea of fairness as we've learned it from God. So, if all have been held accountable for a law, then, if God has given a law to all of us, we need to identify. We need to find. We need to identify and study and follow that law. Now, so far I've been assuming that that law is contained in the Bible because I've been quoting scriptures to prove some of the points. But what I've kind of pondered this week, if the Bible is not that law from God, where is it? What is it? I know some kind of want to discount the Bible, but some people want to discard the Bible. Some don't want to not even consider the Bible. But if God has a law for every man, what is that law for us today? And I will tell you, if it's not in the Bible, I don't know what it is. Where do I look? Do I look to Muhammad? Do I look to the Constitution? Where do I look for God's will for me if I don't look in the Bible? So some people, I think, are kind of wanting to say, well, the Bible is that old book, it's passé, all of those things. I'd like to ask them, the people who completely discount the Bible, where are they looking? What are they considering the source of God's message for man today? What are they considering the revelation of God's law for man today? We can prove everybody's under a law. Have we thought carefully enough about what that law is and where we find it? So, we need to find that law, we need to follow that law. And let me say, if it's the Bible, then we need to follow all of it. The Bible says that all of the scriptures are inspired. Not an unfamiliar verse to you, I know. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, that's teaching. For reproof, that's proving things. For correction, well, we know what that is. For instruction in righteousness. Righteous. If you had to pick one word to describe what God wants us to be, righteous would not be a bad choice. That includes, that contains, that covers, that comprehends many of the things that God wants us to be. God may be for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, if you decide something else is the source of authority for God, from God, well, first, please come tell me what it is. I'd like to investigate that, too. But if you conclude the Bible is our source of authority from God, let's point out that we cannot pick and choose parts of the Bible. All Scripture is inspired. And it's just kind of a logical thing. I hope a lot of this is logical. If I say, well, I believe this, I'm going to follow this, and I've known people like this, you likely have to, but this over here, I just don't think this is right. Whose judgment are we following? Are we following God's judgment? No, we're following our judgment. I have superimposed my judgment above God's judgment, and I say, yes, all of this is from God, but this is right, and this is wrong, and this is right, and this is wrong. What arrogance a person must have to say, well, all the scripture's from God. But you know, I don't really believe all of it. I don't really think I have to follow all of it. This is good for me today. This is not good for me today. It's there. It's inspired. It's accurate. I think you take it or leave it as a package. If we pick and choose parts of the Bible, we are putting our judgment above God's judgment. We are putting our judgment above God's expressed will. So, if it's the Bible, we need to follow all of it. We can't pick and choose. You know, somebody pointed out, it's almost humorous, it's almost insolent, but God didn't call them the Ten Suggestions, did he? When God has expressed his will to us, their commands, we need to follow it. So, if we pick and choose parts of the Bible, we are putting our judgment over God's expressed will. If it is the Bible, would a righteous God give us instructions that we can't understand? Now, it's almost blasphemous to say that. And yet, that's what many people believe. They say, oh yeah, I believe the Bible, but you know, there's so many parts of it I can't understand. And again, all of these scholars in these academic institutions, they disagree so much, people can't understand the Bible. Well, what an insult to God. Is it consistent with your concept of fairness and righteousness for God to give us instructions that we cannot understand? It's not consistent with mine. The Bible says we can understand the Bible. God instructs us to understand his will. Ephesians 5:17, therefore do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And I'll just point out that understand is in the imperative, it's an imperative verb. God's commanding us to understand his will. With the God you believe in, the God of the Bible, is that consistent with your belief about God that he would command us to do something that we can't do? No. He has commanded us to understand his will. So, yes, we can understand God's will for us. You know, maybe if my logic is faulty somewhere in this presentation, by all means, come and talk to me and tell me. Send me an email. Don't send me a Facebook message. Don't post it on my Facebook stand. Your logic is just so messed up. Send me a private message. So we can understand God's will for us. We can. Specifically, God says that we can understand his written will for us. We saw the example of that in Ephesians 5:17. In the Bible, God says we can understand the Bible. So I would suggest to you it ill behooves us to say, I can't understand the Bible. What that usually means is people are unwilling to put forth the time and the effort. It takes some effort to understand the Bible. And sometimes as we're studying the Bible, sometimes there are areas where we have to dig deep. We wind up consulting others about what their view is. We look at a commentary to see what their view is. I would never suggest using a commentary to determine what you believe about something. But I would suggest using a number of commentaries to see what the range of options are about what a passage might say. So, we can understand the Bible. Paul wrote to his audience, and he says, when you read what I've written, you will understand that Ephesians 3:4, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. I tell you, if we can understand the knowledge that Paul had, that's a lot of knowledge. I pointed out as an example in the past, Timothy understood, 2 Timothy 3:15, and that from the childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. It's an interesting verse. Timothy was a youth when he began to study the Bible from his mother and grandmother. What Paul is talking about here is the understanding that Timothy had of the Old Testament Scriptures. A couple of things. One is we say, oh no, those are really, really hard to understand. Well, Timothy understood it as a youth. And also, notice, it says it can make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. We would never want to underestimate the underpinning that the Old Testament is for the New Testament. We would never want to underestimate how much of that Old Testament we need to understand to be able to understand the New Testament. We've commented before, as we take of the Lord's Supper, we use unleavened bread. Why? We use unleavened bread because we know that when Christ established that feast, the example that we follow, he was keeping a Passover feast. So it's because of the example of when it was set that we know what it is. We don't know what the bread used and the Lord's Supper was, except, or and the Passover was, except through those Old Testament scriptures. So yeah, and it says Timothy, wise for salvation which through faith which is in Christ Jesus. Timothy understood those from his youth, and that was the Old Testament. Now, are people expected to understand the Bible? Well, let's look at some statements in the Bible. Parts of books were addressed to husbands, wives, slaves, and children. Some of those we may have assessed that in that era were probably not very educated, not very literally educated, but they were expected to understand. There are verses that for slaves, I put the one that was for children. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. All were expected to understand the instructions for them that were in the Bible. So if we say, well, we just can't understand the Bible, nobody can understand the Bible today, we're flying in the face of a lot of the scriptures in the Bible. And I've noted before, whole books were to be read to congregations. Now, this is interesting. It's interesting for several reasons. One is there have been times in history that some religious groups prohibited the people in the pews from reading the scriptures. There was one group that chained the Bible to some part of the stadium or some part of the pulpit, so people could not take it home and study it on their own. So, what does Paul say? He says, I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read to all the holy brethren. Scriptures were to be read to the whole congregation. Why? Just to take up time? Just as a time-wasting exercise? No, they were to be read to all the people because all the people could understand them and all the people were expected to obey them. Another verse, that was 1 Thessalonians 5:27, Colossians 4:16. Paul wrote to the church at Colossae, now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. So, what do we learn from that? We learn that when Paul wrote to a church, the instructions were not just for that one church. They were valid instructions. They were applicable instructions to other religious groups. And I think if we look through there, if we put the pieces together, we see that all the scriptures were for all the people. All the scriptures were for all Christians, and the Bible is for us today. All of the Bible is for us today. We see the implication of that as we look at how they were used back in that time. So the question is, can we understand the Bible? I would suggest that yes, we can. Now, I started by saying we're going to kind of consider this from the point of view, our answers to these questions, what do they say about God? Well, if you answer that question no, that we can't understand the Bible, I think you're making a very unfair accusation against God. You're saying that he has given me instructions that I can't understand. Now, who would do that? It seems apparent that not a fair God. A God that is fair is going to give instructions that can be understood. If there is a God, if there is an authorized entity that gives instructions that can't be understood, I think that calls into question their fairness. So, how you answer that question indicates something about what you believe about God. It indicates your faith in God or lack of faith in God. It indicates your concept of the fairness of God or accuses God of unfairness. Yes, we can understand the Bible. Now, the second question was, can we understand the Bible alike? And I believe the answer to that also has to be yes. We can understand the Bible alike. In fact, that's the only way we can understand it. And that may sound like kind of a strong statement. But if I have understood the Bible, and you have understood the Bible, then our understandings are going to be exactly the same. If our understandings are based on the Bible. If our understandings are not the same, then one of us has misunderstood the Bible, which is always a possibility. Maybe we both misunderstood it. But if we understand, if we have an accurate understanding of the Bible, if both of us do, then we are going to have the same understanding. Can we understand the Bible alike? Yes, we can. That's the only way we can understand it. Only a misunderstanding by one or both can bring a difference. So, not only can we understand the Bible alike, we must understand it alike, or someone has misunderstood it. Yes, we can understand the Bible, God's instructions alike, because if that were not the case, Paul would not be able to command the Christians in his era to have the same mind, to have the same thinking. 1 Corinthians 1:10, we look at the prayer of Jesus, and I'll look at that in a minute, that prays for unity. But what does unity mean? I believe in 1 Corinthians 1:10, Paul defines unity. 1 Corinthians 1:10, now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same things, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. Is there unity among religious groups today? If you ask all of the different religious groups a question, what's necessary for salvation? How should we worship? Do they have the same judgment about that? Do they have the same discernment? Do they have the same mind? No. They answer that question many different ways. If you answer the same question different ways, you do not have unity. Paul says you need to speak the same thing. Have the same mind. That is, you need to be thinking the same way about important spiritual things and the same judgment. You need to be applying the scriptures to come to the same decisions. So, yes, we can understand the Bible alike. Otherwise, Paul would not have been able to say things like that, command things like that. If we don't have the same standard, we're not going to have unity. And don't we see that in the religious world today? So, yes, we can understand the Bible alike. That's why the New Testament so consistently speaks of the in the singular faith. Acts 6, verse 7, great many of the priests were obedient to the faith. Again, faith there is not belief. The faith is the doctrine. Sometimes in the past, people have talked about the Baptist faith or the Catholic faith. Well, it's in that use of the word here that we can be obedient to the faith, except in that case, it's the one true faith of our Lord Jesus Christ that's found in the Bible. Ephesians 4:5 talks about one Lord, one faith, one baptism. 1 Timothy 6:10, Paul writes to Timothy that some have strayed from the faith. You know, if there is not a well-understood set of instructions, then you couldn't really say that somebody strayed from it, could you? You can stray from it because the standard is given to all as well understood. Jude 1:3, to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. In the past year, year and a half, I have seen some religious groups look at their websites, and they talk about a number of different faiths. They talk about a faith that's a broad faith that all have. Then they talk about a corporate faith. Then they talk about an individual faith. I don't find that in the scriptures. In fact, what happens is if we claim, oh, you can have your faith, I can have my faith, that's just a repackaging of the old argument. You believe what you want to believe, I'll believe what I want to believe. They have dignified the diversity of beliefs by calling them a faith. Well, it's a faith in the sense of a different belief. But it really points out the fact that they are not trying to have the same unity that the scriptures call for. If we have different faiths in the sense of teaching and doctrine, then we don't have the same faith. And at least as far as we're concerned, there is not the faith. There are those faiths. It's not found in the Bible. It's the faith. So, yes, we must understand the Bible alike. Okay. Strayed from the faith, 1 Timothy 6:10, Jude 1:3, to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. Once for all. So is God updating the faith today? It's not what it says. Once for all delivered to the saints. So, can we understand the Bible alike? Yes, we must understand the Bible alike. And why? What are the motivations for understanding the Bible alike? Well, if we don't, we can't have the unity Paul talks about in the letter to the Corinthians. We can't be speaking the same thing. We can't be believing the same thing, deciding the same thing. But we may remember the prayer of Jesus. I alluded to it earlier. John 17, 20, and 21. And again, this is the Lord's prayer in the sense of the prayer that Jesus prayed. What's he praying for? He's praying for unity among his followers. John 17, 20, I do not pray for you. He's been praying for his apostles. This was the night that Jesus was betrayed. The apostles were about to go through a very difficult time. They were about to see their Savior and good friend rejected, beaten, ultimately crucified. So, he's praying for them. And then in verse 20, the prayer takes a turn. Jesus ceases praying just for the apostles, and he begins to pray for others. He begins to pray for you and me. He begins to pray for us. John 17, 20, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. He's praying for those who will believe in him through the words of the apostles. He's been praying about the apostles. Isn't that us? Aren't we some of those who believe in Christ because of the writings of the apostles? I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me, what are the doctrinal differences between the Father and the Son? Not any. That they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. What is one of the greatest barriers to teaching the truth to the religious world today? I think one of the greatest challenges we face in teaching the truth, the true doctrine, Christ's doctrine, to the world is they have so many other choices. You know, they say attend the church of your choice. Well, you look through their doctrine book and say, yeah, I want to do that. Oh, I don't want to do that. And you go through and you go down the menu. And you can find one, I guarantee you can find one that will allow you to do what you want to do. It will not prohibit any of those things. That's why there's not unity in the world. That's one reason. Don't believe me, believe what Jesus says. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe. How different would it be today if every one of the churches on every corner taught exactly the same doctrine? What a difference that would be. So, can we understand the Bible alike? Can we understand the Bible? Yes, we can. If you don't believe the Bible is God's instructions to us, please come tell me what you think it is. I want to take a look at it. I believe it's the Bible. If it's not, I need to find out. I'm getting old. I need to find out soon. If that's not it, then what is? Those who want to say, well, you know, that old book. Well, if you want to criticize the Bible, if you want to denigrate the Bible, if you want to try to discredit the Bible, tell me what you're following. I want to know. I want to know what it is. I'd like to see if there's anything that can stack up with the credibility of the Bible. Historically, accurately, scientifically, all of those things. But to be able to understand the Bible alike, we must be willing to take time to study. I think that's one of the problems that we have. people are no longer good students. I think a lot of people are no longer good students in school, and they're no longer students, good students of God's Word. When I was growing up in the 50s and 60s and 70s, members of the Lord's Church were known as, what was it? Bible-toting, Scripture-quoting. Could we still earn that reputation today? How many hours a week do we spend studying the Bible? I hope you study the Bible more than just listening to me. That would be kind of dangerous to be listening to just one person, wouldn't it? We must be willing to take time to study the Bible. The Bible is the most important book we'll ever study. We should apply our best abilities in the most diligent way to understand its truths. Sometimes I believe that if I'm going to study a physics text, or you're going to study a history text or whatever, it's like, oh man, I gotta get out my A brain to study this. I want to make sure I understand it. But when you're preparing for Bible class, do you really take it that seriously? Do you really say, hey, let me go get a fresh glass of water, a fresh glass of milk, a fresh cup of coffee, whatever. I'm going to have to really concentrate. The Bible is worthy of our greatest study. We should be striving to grow in our ability to study the Bible. I think it was Lou Holtz that said, don't give me a young man that wants to win. Don't give me a man who's willing to win. Give me one who's willing to practice. And I think that's what we have to be with God's Word. We have to be willing to put in the time practicing, studying. And if we spend the time, studying, not only are we going to be more confident in our salvation, not only are we going to be better discerners of who we want to worship with or study with, we're going to be much more confident in teaching other people. So, I think I have another bullet. Can we understand the Bible alike? Number one, yes, we can understand. If you don't believe you can understand the Bible, if you believe the Bible is from God, if you don't believe you can understand the Bible, then aren't you making a terrible accusation against God? He has given you something as the standard of your life that you can't understand. But we can understand it, and we can understand it alike. That's the only basis for harmony. So, what do we do with the information? Well, we don't want to be that right-only memory. We put those facts in our mind and never act upon them. Is there something in your life you need to act upon? Do you need to obey the fundamental teachings of how to become a Christian? I think most in this audience have. Maybe some who are listening have not. You need to believe and repent and confess and be baptized. Give us a call. We'll sit down with you and we'll show you multiple scriptures for each one of those. But maybe the thing that all of us still need to do is purpose to spend more time studying the Bible. If there is some way we can help you this evening, please come forward as we stand and sing.
Who at the door is standing, patiently drawing near, entrance within demanding, whose is the voice I hear? Sweetly the tones are calling, open the door for me, if thou wilt heed my call. Thou not weary, waiting so long for me. Sweetly the tones are calling, open the door for me, if thou wilt heed my calling, desires to partake of the Lord's Supper? I don't see any hands. So we'll have the announcements then.
So glad to see everyone here tonight. Let me just run through some announcements. I do have some updates. First of all, we've been praying for Dan Potter, Bill Potter's son. We found out this morning that last night Dan Potter did pass away. And we don't know any further details from that, but he did pass away last night, or yesterday. Robert Shaw has placed membership with us, so let's be sure to welcome him into the fellowship. We're glad you're here. Glad you're here, brother. We had a real good talk. And there's a lot more we need to learn, too, about a lot to know, so that's good. One of the HAL members, Wiley, had been in the hospital recovering from a brain aneurysm, but he was with us today, so this is a good thing. Jeanette Jones added to our prayer list with problems with her shoulder, and she can't get an MRI until later this month, so she's going to be in a bit of pain for a while. I don't know how often we'll see her here until she gets something to help out with that. Men's breakfast, April 8th at 8 a.m. Let's not forget that. Men's assignments posted. Molly and Stephanie will be taking pictures for those who need updates to their pictures on the bulletin board and in our directory. Let's remember our gospel meeting over the next few weeks. Please make plans to attend every part of it as we can. And we'll also have a congregational potluck on the 16th, the first night or the first day of the lectureship or the gospel meeting. We announced this morning the result of our preacher search. We've concluded that, and we've selected Justin Guest to fill the position. And we do thank everyone for your support and for your input on that. Those are all the announcements that I have right now, and so let's stand and sing our closing song and have our closing prayer.
Number 163, He Keeps Me Singing. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Not I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting 'neath His sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall live with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Pray with me, please. Holy Father in heaven, we thank You again for this day, this opportunity, another day of life that we have to come and we're able to worship You together. Father, we pray that we will take to heart the lessons that have been presented today, that we will ponder on them, meditate on them, Father, and search for opportunities to preach the gospel. Father, we pray for our members that are in need of various support for physical, for mental, for emotional. Father, we pray that we have opportunity that we can do that. We ask that you'll watch over us and keep us safe. Father, we pray for our elders and the work they're doing here. Help us to take every opportunity to support them in that work. Father, be with us as we leave. We ask that you'll continue to watch over each and every one of us. We thank you so much for your Son, for his sacrifice, and that through him we have a hope of eternal life. We ask that you'll be with us now as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm.